that leads to nothing but destruction. When we're void of God, it ultimately leads to nothing but destruction in our life. That's the reason why people who are sinners, their life begins to disintegrate over time. People who are alcoholics and drug addicts and this addict or that, or just hooked on. How many of you know people who are adrenaline junkies? I was reading an article the other day about people who have put themselves in dangerous positions to take a selfie. We call them stupid. This article called them dead. There was one about this girl. She climbed out on top of a bridge that was already way up. She climbed 30 feet up to the top of that bridge to take a selfie. Here's a beautiful picture. She's like this, click, smile, and next thing you know, bloop, dead. All for a selfie. That's how quick sin will take you down, though. In just a moment of time. You think back just a few months ago, you know, if we come into this thing, and you know there's people who come into church every Sunday and their life is empty and void of God. There's people who go to church that have never surrendered or have ever been saved. Now, you've heard me quote Tom Rainer of Lifeway, who says that about 40% of the people won't come back to church after the COVID. Now, I don't know how many of those maybe weren't saved. The one thing that I do know is in the book of Matthew, when it starts talking about, two will be in the field, one will be taken, one will be left. I mean, it gave us several examples. At best, 50%. The Bible says narrow is the road, the path, and few that find it. There's a lot of people who show up at church on Sundays. They're just like the Christmas tree. How many of you had a live Christmas tree? Y'all always have a live Christmas tree. Anybody else have live Christmas trees in their house? How many of you know you get that tree, you decorate it, it's pretty. But you know that tree is dead. The moment it is separated from its roots, that tree is dead. Now, it takes a while for that death to show up. And it takes, if something marvelous that happens, because you decorate this tree and you put all these beautiful ornaments and lights and everything, and man, it's just pretty, but it's dead. And people come into church the same way. They decorate themselves. They put their makeup on, thank God. I mean, they come in, you take a bath, hallelujah. You decorate yourself and you look good on the outside, but you're dead on the inside, because you've never connected yourself to the root, and his name is Jesus. What does that tell us? That maybe we need to maybe we should not be as concerned about the outward as we are what's taking place on the inside of us. Now, I'm not telling you not to take a bath. Please do. We're not one of those churches, Pentecostal churches, that tell you not to wear makeup, because if you need it, wear it. And if you really need it, wear even more. And if I could get by with it, I probably need it too. I got wrinkles and blemishes, but, godly men can't wear makeup. Thank you, David. I need at least one amen out of that before I get myself in trouble. Let's move on. So here we are, the house of God. He designed it. Sin desecrated it and brought desolation because God had to move away. And destruction begins to happen. But you know what the good news is? Jesus made a way for his house to be built in you. He says in chapter 21 of Matthew, he said, my house should be called a house of prayer for all people, but you have made it a den of thieves. Look, we don't want to be a den of thieves. We want to be a house of prayer. He's not just talking about a house like this. He's talking about us. We're to be houses of prayers. Now, I am talking about corporately as a body, bringing yourself together to pray, but how many of you know you need to be a house of prayer? You need to be the design of God. God designed you for who you are. Let him have his way in your life. Amen? A house designed by God. In Matthew 24, verse 1 and 2, as Jesus was leaving the temple grounds, his disciples pointed out to him the various temple buildings. And he responded, he said, do you see all these buildings? I tell you the truth, they will completely be demolished and not one stone will be left on top of the other. He was saying, look, all these buildings, they don't mean anything. Because one day they're going to be all torn down. They're all going to diminish, destroyed. Some get destroyed. We had some churches that got destroyed when the tornado hit a year ago. Houses and other things that got destroyed, utterly destroyed. How many of you know those kind of things can happen in a moment's time? But God has built a house. Matter of fact, the psalmist says, unless the Lord build the house, they that labor, labor in vain. See, here's the thing, is you can try to build it all you want to. You can try to build yourself up all you want to, but unless the Lord's building you up, your efforts are in vain. Now, that doesn't mean you don't do some things, but you do some things as being led by the Spirit of Almighty God. He tells us in Jude, verse 20, build up your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. You build up your faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. You build, you know, faith cometh by hearing and hearing the word of God. There's things that he has told us to do. He's trying to build something in you. As a matter of fact, he told David a great Old Testament story. David wanted to build God a house. He wanted to build him a temple. But God said, David, look, you can't build it. You're too bloody. But I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. If you will just do what I tell you, I'm going to build you a house. Now, everybody thought, well, maybe he's just talking about this. No, God built an elaborate temple through his son Solomon that was the envy of everything in the world. The problem is Solomon, like most men, began to desecrate it as time went on with sin. But he told David, you can't build it, but I'll build you something. Can I tell you today, God is building something. We've seen in John chapter 14 that Jesus said, look, don't be afraid, don't be weary, don't be sad, because I've gone away to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also. Aren't you glad, praise God, that he's building us an everlasting temple, a place to dwell with him forever? Book of Revelation says John saw a city coming down out of heaven, and it was the new heaven, then it was the new earth. God is making something brand new that is everlasting and that you and I will dwell in forever. But we've got to let God build it. You got to let God build you. We did this theme around here many, many years ago. It was part of an Assembly of God thing, and it's called We Build People. Remember that? That's a long time ago. I loved that because I felt like that God is doing something. He builds people. He builds you. He builds me. I love that thought. Now, it went by the wayside, as a lot of ideas do. But are we letting God build us today? Are you letting him build you? Because, see, Adam took what God made and he sinned. And he desecrated it, and it became desolate, and destruction came even to his own family when one of his sons killed his brother because of sin. Sin will take you further than you ever planned to go. But oh, but praise God, his grace and his righteousness will carry you places you never dreamed you could be. I've seen people, there was a man in my dad's life who was his best friend from when they were young boys. Matter of fact, they roamed the streets together and got into all kinds of trouble. And this guy was a mean dude. He was always nice to us, and he and my dad loved each other. They were dear friends, but he was mean. He got in a fight one time at a bar, was shot 3 times, and still whipped 3 guys. That's how mean he was. He was drunk too, but I mean, he was so enraged by that, literally could have died. Had been stabbed. He was just mean. He was mean to his children, mean to his wives. The only people he's nice to was mom and dad and us. He wasn't nice to a lot of people. He had his own company. He wasn't nice to his workers. He was mean. And he got late in life. My mom used to preach to him all the time. And he used to tell her, he said, "Well, God, never forgive me." And I'll never forget, as he sat in this church, my dad had gone on to heaven, and he sat in here. I think we still had the pews in here. I can't remember. And he was here. I had preached a message. We had an altar call. Several people came to the altar. He sat back there, tears rolling down his eyes, and he held on to the pew. But he couldn't get up. My sister Kelly went back to him after service and put her arm around him. And she said, "Do you want to go and pray with Scott?" He said, "God could never forgive me for everything I've done." And my bold sister just sat there, sat down next to him, and began to preach the gospel to him. There were a lot of people in the Bible just as evil as he's been. Paul killed Christians, and Jesus forgave him. People committed adultery, and God forgave them. And at the end of all that, he's weeping, and he said, "I want to be saved." And right sitting back there, she led him in prayer, and he received Jesus. And the look on his face, God changed something in his temple that day. There was a peace on his face that I had never seen. And about 4 weeks later, he died. He knew his time was coming. I mean, he was sick. He was really sick. He had several things wrong. He knew he was dying. And yet, in those last days of his life, Jesus forgave him. You know what he did? He cleaned that old evil house, and he made it his own. I don't know about y'all, but that's good news to me. Now, the truth is, we shouldn't wait to the end. It's up to God whether he's going to forgive you or not. Don't wait. But God has many stories like that. Some of you were that story. You were that house that had been desecrated and had suffered destruction because you were so far in sin. And yet Jesus came along and said, "Now let me build you the house I want to build in you. It's a house of joy and peace and strength." You say, what does it all come to? I talked about all these things that brought destruction, but I got to tell you something. Is our life doesn't have to end in destruction. It can end in peace and joy and love and the Holy Ghost. Because Jesus loves you. Those of you who are here, you say, "Well, I'm a Christian." Well, praise God for it. But you know, many times we live beneath what God's trying to build inside of us. Today, would you just make this choice that I'm going to let God build his house in me? What he started in the garden, it really wasn't the garden that he was concerned about. It was Adam and Eve. It was mankind made in his image. He's trying to build something in you. He's trying to build something in each and every one of us. The question is though we may have had destructions in our life because of bad decisions. I mean, you ever made bad decisions? Yeah, all of us have. We've made bad decisions and things have happened because of it. But the Lord says, I'll build you a house and I will redeem those things that the cankerworm ate. I'll redeem those things that were destroyed. I'm not just going to rebuild them. I'm going to make them brand new. That's the reason in 2 Corinthians it tells us that old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. He's making something brand new of you. If you're watching us today, can I just tell you? Here's the reality. God wants to build something in you. He wants to build his house. He wants to build his life on the inside of you. But you have to surrender yourself to him. Would you do that today? Those of you who are here, those of you who are watching, just bow your heads for just a moment. Would you just take a moment? All these things that brought destruction, the nation of Israel suffered slavery and destruction over and over and over again. Because of sin in their life, them turning their backs on God. And yet the Lord would forgive them and rebuild them. But can I tell you, you've not gone so far that God can't rebuild your life. You've not been so bad that he can't forgive you. So would you just right now say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Everything I've done wrong, God, I surrender my life to you. Come build your life in me, Jesus. I don't belong to me anymore. I belong to you. Now, if you've prayed that prayer, if you're here, maybe you've wandered from God. Maybe you've wandered from God. Would you just surrender and come back to the master? He's the master builder. Let him build you to be his house. Amen. Well, praise God. I hope that you've enjoyed that. I hope it ministered to you tonight. We'll continue in the book of Acts next week. Praise God. I love the book of Acts. It's a great, great teaching time, and we just enjoy it. Hope you're enjoying it. So, hey, look, if you prayed that prayer, if you would just send us a comment or a direct message to the Bellshire page, and we will get that, and we will pray with you. We will minister to your needs, and we'll do what we need to do to help you. Come join us at church Sunday morning at 8:30 and 10:30. We hope that you will come join us. Amen. We look great crowd Sunday. If you're still worried about social distancing, show up at 8:30. We still have plenty of socially distanced seats at 8:30, and we have many at 10:30. Just come be in the house of God. Wear your mask, whatever makes you comfortable, and let's worship Jesus together. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you Sunday.